Hi, I'm Kimberly Britton. I'm the CEO of EPIcenter, and I'm thrilled to be here in Dallas, Texas today, just a few miles from my hometown of Fort Worth. Had to put that in. We're here to talk about a really, truly important topic that is all about energy transition, but not that alone, but as our guest today would like to say, it's energy addition. So we're going to break down the story of a legacy oil and gas set of companies and that family, and why would they be looking and engaging in the energy renewable sector. So we're going to talk about that today. We are here for a literal fireside chat. Well, sort of. And as you know, if you've watched other global lecture series with EPIcenter, this is a tradition for us. So we were thrilled today that it's a continued part of our legacy, but also a part of a tradition here at Hunt. So thank you for that. I have the pleasure today to introduce two energy sector leaders that are going to have a phenomenal conversation about what's going on in energy today. But I would encourage you in the Remo platform, you have an opportunity to enter your questions at any time under the Q&A tab, and I hope you'll do so because we will get to them later in our presentation during the live session. So, leading our discussion today is one of my phenomenal board members, my board chair at EPIcenter. It's Cris Eugster. He also is the chief operating officer of CPS Energy, which is the largest vertically integrated, municipally owned utility in the United States. Cris really has played an important role at CPS Energy and certainly at EPIcenter as one of our founders. But at CPS, he has been integral in the part of establishing it as a leader in renewables, energy efficiency, demand response program, and the grid modernization piece. Previously in Houston, he served under Mayor Bill White as the first chief officer for sustainable growth, and he was a partner at McKinsey focused on high-tech and energy clients. So, our guest today is Hunter Hunt, chairman and CEO of Hunt Energy. They are a private family-owned energy company with a diverse portfolio of energy businesses. A lot of people don't realize how diverse that portfolio is, and I'd like to share a little bit more about it. So they're community-centric, purpose-driven. They have an approach that creates long-term value with that philosophy for their stakeholders. The overall company was founded in 1934, and it's positioned itself across the energy spectrum. So to break it down, Hunt Energy is comprised of Hunt Oil Company and Hunt Refining Company, power-focused Hunt Energy Solutions, technology-focused Hunt Energy Enterprises, and Hunt Utility Services. It operates Sherry Land Utilities, which many people may know about but don't realize it is a Hunt company as well. It's a regulated utility that owns energy transition assets in Texas. Hunter passionately believes that humankind should be at the center of energy, that it should serve the needs of humankind. And it's been with that ideal that he devotes his time to causes that promote community development and broaden the inclusiveness of organizations focused on underserved communities. He serves on myriad of boards, and I realized in the lead up to our conversation today that our two guests have something very important in common. They are both the surviving parents of multiple children. So Cris has twin boys and Hunter has teenage triplets. So with that, I will turn it over to Cris Eugster to lead our discussion today. Cris.
Thank you, Kimberly. And excellent. I didn't realize we had a basketball team in making with Hunter's three and my two. We can field them here.
Yes, and you can be my mentor because I think you're a year ahead of us. So I will continue to learn from the master on how to deal with this multiple issue.
Yeah, well, I think a year, maybe not enough time to have a really good perspective. But thank you so much, Hunter, for being a part of this and the setting here. It's a beautiful building, beautiful location. Really appreciate y'all hosting us. And I'm personally very excited about this conversation. I'm usually talking to utility peers and to have a leader in the oil and gas sector and just really understand that perspective. I think I'm looking very much forward to this, and I know that our community and our stakeholders are as well.
Well, thank you. I must say, like CPS, I think it is such a leading light in the utility industry. And so in many ways, the pleasure is mine. I'm looking forward to the conversation because your leadership and what you've done in energy as the largest municipal in the country, but really being forward thinking in the way that you've put commercial deals together and thought about future energy supply. It's a real pleasure to be here with you.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Hunter. And I also want to say thank you to Kimberly and her team for putting this on, making this happen. So thank you so much for that. So let's start, as Kimberly said, you know, the Hunt family, the Hunt business is well known, you know, certainly across Texas, across the globe, a leader in the industry, in the oil and gas industry. And you're now third generation?
Yes.
As a leader, that's a pretty amazing story. I want to just give you an opportunity to talk a little bit about the company, the family aspect of it, your philosophy, what's important to you, sure. And just turn the floor over to you.
Well, thank you. Thanks. It's as you know, as everybody I think watching this knows, the energy industry is a fabulous industry to be in. It's very dynamic. It's completely intertwined with economic development and human development. And as my father says, if we are a private third generation pizza business, there's nothing wrong with that. But I think it's fair to say what you show up and deal with at the office every day, what's disruption and what innovation is totally different than what it is in energy. And so, we are, as Kimberly said, we're a private company. My grandfather founded Hunt Oil Company in 1934. He left home in eighth grade with a sixth grade education. And so his history is kind of interesting. He bounced around various different industries. He was a lumberjack for a while. He tried out for baseball and didn't make any teams, but he worked on a ranch out in California. He ultimately settled down and became a farmer kind of in this neck of the woods. And he kind of backdoored his way into the oil and gas industry. Starting off first as a mineral rights broker, and then one day woke up and said, you know what, instead of paying me a fee, I'll just take a cut if the well hits. And so that's how he worked his way into the oil industry before being able to play kind of a prominent role in the East Texas oil field. And so, those roots as a family and as a private energy company are, they're important. We talk about it quite a bit and we think about it both for an internal culture as well as when we're out dealing with communities. Because there's nothing about HL that you would look at any stage in the early part of his career to say this is somebody who's going to have a material impact on the world through energy. But there was a creativity, there was a contrarian mindset that he had. There was a fluidity to the way that he had to respond to things that I'll probably come back to at some point. That allowed us to grow and prosper. And so he passed away in 1974. My father took over at that point. He up to that point spent a lot of time on the real estate side. So actually Reunion Tower and the Reunion Hotel here was one of his first projects. But he took us internationally, and that's what brought us into the country of North Yemen at the time. We're in Peru now, we're in Romania. So the global footprint really started with my father. But again, I think marrying real estate almost by definition is local. And with his roots starting off in real estate and growing that into the oil and gas side, and then taking that internationally, just set us apart a little bit from our publicly traded, what are now super majors, but the majors. It's just a bit of a different feel when you sit down with a company and are talking about a 25-year contract to know the person you're sitting across the table from actually really cares what happens in 25 years. Just creates a bit of a different dynamic. And so I joined in late 98. We set up Sharyland Utilities. We received regulatory approval in 1999, but we energized it in February of 2000. And so I've been blessed to be able to be part of adding electrons into the mix at the company. And so we've had Sharyland Utilities. We're now involved. We are involved in batteries in particular, but also solar. If there's a summation of everything, we've tried really hard to keep the mindset of HL back in 1934. And just remembering at the end of the day, it's all about relationships and people in the communities where you are, while at the same time looking at this incredible technological transformation that's going on. And, it's the statistics on surviving the third generation are pretty poor. And that's across all industries. And so, part of my job I really do view as I need to be looking not just at where we are today, but, where are things heading in 10 to 20 years? And how can we continue to both position ourselves, be contrarian, be community-centric, but make sure that we can have a positive role in the energy industry and communities that we try to have and enjoy today?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Hunter, that's a pretty amazing story. And you know, that long-term view, also, you know, caring about, you know, the local community, and also embracing change. I mean, that's pretty remarkable, you know, the type of things you're thinking about, which kind of takes me to my next question. You know, top of mind, you know, coming from the oil and gas sector, what is your vision of energy in the future in 10, 20, 30 years, you know, especially given in context of the carbon discussions, carbon reduction, climate change? Where do you see things going, and how are you positioning yourself?
So it's a great question. You know, when I read the book The Prize by Dan Yergin, it was a number of years ago, but he starts it talking about Winston Churchill and the very fateful decision to switch the British Navy from coal to oil. And you know, that always kind of struck me, because if you go back to the year 1900, you know, coal was king. Every advanced society ran on coal. The greatest military power on the face of the planet, the British Navy, ran on coal. It was very much of a line of demarcation between have and have nots. And yet, you know, a fool could have looked at oil in the year 1900 and said, yeah, but oil's gonna have a really bright future. And you fast forward to the year 2000, you know, it was a century of oil. I mean, you know, wars were fought over oil. You know, the greatest military power on the face of the planet, the U.S. Army, runs on oil. It's a line of demarcation between have and have-nots. And yet, you know, we still, in the year 2000, you know, 50% of our electricity globally and domestically came from coal. And so, you know, as I tell people, you know, don't cry coal companies a river. They did just fine. But there is clearly a transformation that occurred that's propelled society and humanity to where we are today. And so in many ways, Cris, that's how we think about energy as we look forward right now. You know, so much of humanity relies on oil for mobility. And so even when people talk about peak oil, I think there's a concept of somehow when oil peaks, it comes off very hard. And I tend to view oil and natural gas in many ways to kind of coal over the 20th century. It's not likely to grow. It is likely to peak sometime in the near future. But that's different than saying it goes away. And you know, and at the same time, from an environmental perspective, as real as candidly, just a technological perspective, it's clear the energy mix is shifting and being impacted, particularly by wind and solar and batteries. And so, yeah, I think our view is we're proud to be an oil and gas company. We see a need for both fuels for quite some time. But we understand that the planet and humanity and a lot of the communities that we're in are saying, look, that's great, but we have these other needs that are really more around electrons. And you know, I think we view the world right now as people need molecules, they need oil and gas. And you know, coal is still, as we both know, it's a very large part of the energy mix still today on power generation. But increasingly they want electrons. And so if we're truly gonna be community-centric and serve humanity, that's where we need to be shifting into. So we really do view this more as an energy addition with new sources showing up than an energy transition where we're getting out of oil and gas in the near term completely into something separate.
So it sounds like you're positioning yourself. So it sounds like the next big play is electrification, electrons, but how fast things shift is still somewhat unknown based on technologies and markets and things like that. But you're positioning your company to be flexible so that you can adapt to whatever the market conditions are.
That's right. And again, just thinking at it at a very high level, you know, in pre-COVID, you know, heading into January, the world was consuming around 100 million barrels of oil a day. And you know, as we tell folks, it's fascinating because, you know, effectively every single day, you know, there are 100 million barrels that were discovered decades, or almost always at least years before, were extracted from the ground, delivered to refineries on a daily basis, cracked open into a myriad of products, diesel, gasoline, jet fuel, feedstocks for petrochemical applications, and then delivered to 7.5 billion people on the face of the planet in the form that they want on a daily basis. I mean, it is the most pervasive, omnipresent supply and distribution system mankind has ever created. It puts Jeff Bezos to shame. And as we know, there are fragile aspects to it, but it's everywhere. And so we kind of view that in one corner. In the other corner are wind, solar, and battery. And as you know, especially with CPS, y'all have been at the forefront of this, but as we've been blessed in Texas with wind in particular, we had a front row seat at the beginning of this technological revolution. Those are declining cost curve industries. Every year, the cost of that technology is reducing without fail. And so the one thing we know with certainty is a year from now, wind, solar, and batteries are going to be cheaper than they are today. We know 2 years they'll be cheaper than what they are a year from now. That's not true with oil and gas. We've had decades of increasing marginal cost and decades of decreasing marginal cost. So renewables are going to win, to be clear. But the supply chains, the distribution chains, the waste disposal chains are wholly underformed compared to petroleum products. And then you have effectively the step-up manufacturing challenges of, you know, you're going to hit a level where all of a sudden, you know, we're going to run into problems. And so we sit here looking at this, having had a foot in the utility space for 20 years and being very active in the oil and gas space for quite some time. And, you know, we kind of view it as the mother of all battles in some ways. But what we do think is there's going to be a lot of volatility, price volatility associated with this. And so, you know, it's funny, Cris, we talk about being flexible. One of our senior officers last week said something I thought was fascinating. Flexibility implies that you bend or you morph yourself from where you are. And we all think about being flexible as kind of shifting. And he was contrasting that to fluidity. And fluidity is kind of, you think about it as a liquid kind of rushing around things. But you aren't anchored in a spot. And I think more and more energy companies are going to have to think with that fluid mindset of, you know, if you're trying to adapt yourself from where we are in 2020, I think that's going to be a lot harder than waking up every day saying, where's technology? Where's humanity? How can we best serve? And again, this is why I really tip my hat to CPS. Y'all are a leader in that kind of thinking in many ways.
I think, like you said, Texas is a unique place. I mean, it's got a lot of resources. It's got wind, solar. You know, now we're seeing battery storage come into play. It's got a market, a structure which allows a lot of innovation, a lot of companies coming in and trying different things. And you all are doing some very interesting things on the utility side with, you know, shale land initially, but now you're in energy storage. And love to kind of hear your thoughts about those businesses and your vision for them and where they're going.
Sure. So Sherryland, we started and we energized it back in February of 2000.
And that's a transmission.
That was a transmission and distribution utility originally. And we started it on a 6,000 acre real estate development in between McAllen and Mission, Texas. And it was an onion farm that the family had owned since the 70s. And my father held on to it because he said 6,000 acres on the Mexican-American border right off the Rio Grande River has got to be worth something more than farmland at some point. And so I joke, we did what all good farmers do. We lost money on sugar. We lost money on onions. We lost money on oranges. But when NAFTA came in 98, we realized, okay, as part of the Maquiladora twin plant development that was starting to kick in, we could redevelop it. And while a lot of companies wanted the labor-intensive activities in Mexico, they had either energy-intensive or distribution activities on the U.S. side. So we actually started up a greenfield utility in 2000. And it's not even a joke. Our first customer was a softball field. So we were the only nighttime peaking utility in the country, and we peaked Monday, Wednesdays, and Friday nights. And so, but that was transmission and distribution. We built the DC interconnection with Mexico to help with reliability at that point in time. And you know, then when Caprock Energy came up for sale, we purchased Caprock, which was a roll-up of four co-ops that became an IOU that we purchased back in 2010. And that's out over the Permian Basin. And so we spent a lot of we grew along with the Permian Basin, although we were still quite rural, even when we sold. And so, you know, we grew that. We had a different kind of financing vehicle that we used. And ultimately, and again, this is where I think as companies, energy companies, we need to have an ear. As the regulatory view of, we had a real estate investment structure, a real estate investment trust structure we had, as the view of that changed, we needed to change with it. And so, you know, we ultimately sold we sold all of our holdings up in the West Texas area. We've kept the transmission side, as you said. And that's part of it is we're still bullish on more and more renewables showing up and more economic development showing up in Texas. And you know, I kind of joke that people don't like to live where it's windy or hot, and so we continue to believe there'll be opportunities as renewables develop in Texas for more transmission, and our hope is to grow like we did the first time around, partner with munis and co-ops, and figure out what are those areas where there's a symbiotic relationship. So we still have a utility; it's much smaller now, and it's in the Rio Grande Valley, transmission focused. You know, the structure that was set up in 99 with SB7, with the bill that deregulated the market, I mean, it has served the state so well, introducing competition with the investor-owned utilities while actually allowing munis and co-ops to innovate themselves in a different manner. But, you know, increasingly, as battery technologies have become more competitive and as we have more renewables driving demand for batteries, you know, we've been looking at this and saying, you know, we think there's an interesting opportunity here from a storage perspective. And as we've looked at that, and as we look again at what it sounds like the legislature and our elected leaders are telling us, that's probably a better place to be in the unregulated market than it is on the regulated side. And so we are. We've actually launched a venture with Pat Wood, the godfather of our market at the helm, on the distribution level batteries, and then we actually have a couple of technology plays in the battery space, so very early stage technology plays, and we have one in the perovskite solar cell as well, but our view is
beyond lithium ion,
actually it's in the perovskite space, so it's kind of considered the next generation solar cell, but we have a it's a solutions-based delivery system. So it doesn't, it's a much cheaper way of ultimately manufacturing it if we get to commercial scale with it. But again, this is part of our desire to keep looking around the corner as a private multi-generational company to say what's coming next. But we are excited, again, to be in Texas. God bless Texas we have the underlying growth, we have the renewables, and so we really do think there's some interesting opportunities in batteries.
Right, yeah. Yeah, we also, I mean, we're a leader in solar. We're number one in the state of Texas, number five in the country. We did the big 400 megawatt solar project, yes, 8 years ago, a landmark project.
Combined with amazing economic development that came with it.
Amazing economic development with our OCI partners. And we're looking to, with the Flex Power Bundle, put another 900 megawatts of solar, because solar, quite frankly, for us aligns very well with our load. If it's a hot August afternoon, 105 degrees, the sun is usually shining. Those solar panels are usually producing. So with wind, there's a little bit more variability, but with solar, there is more consistency. But the battery storage is key for us, because if we can extend that solar peak, you know, beyond 6 o'clock, 7 to 8 o'clock at night, when folks are at home and you know, running air conditioners, that really, you know, brings solar to a whole different level. So I'm very encouraged with y'all's vision and your investment in energy storage here in Texas. And I've heard some pretty large numbers of, you know, gigawatts of storage coming in play. So you do think that it's coming in a real way here in Texas.
We do. And again, y'all in many ways, y'all will be at the forefront yet again. We've seen a number of other companies, as you know, piling into the space. And you know, it's interesting going back to this energy addition or how the energy sector transforms itself. You know, there are many people that look at the environmental benefits of natural gas, certainly versus coal. But even when you start looking at oil, and they're really different applications in many ways, but I think there are a lot of people that say oil will decrease much quicker than natural gas. And yet, you know, our head of technology here back in 2007 put up a very simple 2x2 graph or grid of, you know, does the technology, does it support mobility or is it stationary on one axis? And the other one was, can it utilize existing infrastructure or does it require new infrastructure on the other axis? And then they put up wind, solar, natural gas, this is 07, so nuclear, modular nuclear, all these different things. And the only technology that supports mobility, which is a great megatrend, and I think post-COVID will still be a great megatrend with humanity, and that could utilize existing infrastructure was the internal combustion engine. And so that's what caused us to become very bullish on oil. The intriguing thing, I think, about batteries in particular and natural gas is if you gave me the debate card to say that actually natural gas may be knocked out of the energy mix quicker than oil, I think I could actually debate that pretty effectively because the primary applications of natural gas are stationary. It's been 2x1 combined cycles, it's been peakers, it's been industrial applications for sure. But the more that storage shows up with the incredible cost of wind and solar, as y'all have seen repeatedly, you know, you're going to see the pressure you already have on the peaker side, but it's fascinating. You can see a complete transformation of what people think the supply mix is for electrons quicker than what I think others may, and it may be more bearish for natural gas than a lot of folks are contemplating now.
Yeah, it's fascinating. Like you said, there's so many different moving parts, and some of it is technology-driven, market-driven, regulatory-driven. You know, back to your mobility thing, that's fascinating. It, you know, I would love to get your views on electric vehicles. You know, are electric vehicles versus combustion engines? You know, you hear California wanted to go, you know, all EVs down the road. What are your thoughts on the EVs? Are they going to be a niche play, or are they going to be more of a play here over the next decade or so?
So it's funny because there are a lot of holy wars that have broken out around this, as you can imagine, especially on the oil and gas side. And so we try to stay out of that. I guess we've seen a number of the presentations. I'm sure you probably have seen it of Wall Street around 1908 when it's all horses and there's one car, and then 1918 it's all cars and there's like one horse. And so I think there's a lot of excitement around EVs. And let's put aside the discussion earlier about the supply chains, distribution chains, you know, waste chain. I mean, put all of that aside. When oil showed up to the scene on the mobility front, you know, its primary application for people were horses. And so, you know, when cars started showing up, you know, horses couldn't get together and say, well, you know, this sucks. What do we do? You know, what's the game plan here? How are we going to get out of this? You know, there was no horse version 2.0. You couldn't cram two horses together. And so in many ways, oil had easy pickings when it came to mobility to step in. You know, you fast forward to today and, you know, EVs are clearly part of our future, as they need to be. I mean, you know, from an environmental perspective, and there are a lot of incremental growth opportunities. We're believers in EVs, but to think that the entire global ecosystem around the internal combustion engine is going to look at this and say, "Bah, well, too bad. They're here. We're just going to kind of walk away." I think is wholly underestimating the amount of innovation that you're going to see coming out of the oil sector to make internal combustion engines both cleaner and more efficient. I think the other challenge that comes out of this is, you have the plug-in issues around EVs. You know, you have, I think, you know, it's easy to envision EVs taking over Menlo Park and Silicon Valley. There are a lot of issues in urban cores about, how do you charge it? How does that kind of play out from a logistical perspective? I guess our view on EVs is they're coming far slower than what most EV proponents believe, but far quicker than what most oil company executives are clinging on to. And we'll just kind of see how that plays out.
Yeah, exactly. Not to go off on a tangent, yeah, I'd love to get your perspective on hydrogen, the hydrogen economy. How do you think about that? Is that part of your sort of new technology mix as well, or?
So it is. So we have people looking at hydrogen. And again, from an oil and gas perspective, it is such a logical thing to explore, because it doesn't take a lot of imagination to look at existing infrastructure. You know, pulling out natural gas molecules, sticking in hydrogen molecules, changes clearly that need to occur at various different points along the way. So we absolutely are looking at hydrogen. You know, when you get into the kind of green versus blue versus, you know, gray, the source of hydrogen matters to different people in terms of is it really pure? Is it coming out of oil and gas application? And so it's something that, again, we will respond as leaders and policy is written. And I absolutely think there's a growth opportunity there on the hydrogen side. People love electrons.
You're saying it's a little bit further behind than renewables.
I think
and
it's further
storage.
Behind, and I actually think it's. I don't think it'll ever be as popular as an electrified world. I think there'll absolutely be the applications for it, but there's still a lot of work to do to make it bigger and broader. And I think it'll evolve slower again than what a lot of people in the oil and gas space think that it will.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, makes sense. I want to ask you, I mean, you really are with your company thinking, you know, in a very transformative way. You see a little bit of that in the oil and gas sector. Some, you know, you hear some folks, press releases out there, you know, moving forward. But you also see some companies doubling down on kind of traditional businesses. What is your take on, do you think the rest of the oil and gas sector companies, are they going to follow Hunt's lead into kind of thinking more innovatively, more transformatively around some of these newer technologies?
So it is. As you said, it's fascinating when you look at the totality of the oil and gas industry today, and in particular the super majors, the BP, Shell, Chevron's, Total's. In Europe, they very much have moved towards a model of saying we're energy companies, Total has been a shareholder in SunPower for years now. From that perspective, you know, Shell has made a very broad and bold move into things. BP was in solar, then they got out, but they're back in, and so it's but the European super majors have said we're energy companies. Chevron and Exxon, for the most part, putting aside some press releases, effectively have said we're oil companies, and they've somewhat doubled down on it. You hear the odd press release on algae or their technology groups, but by and large, they stayed in the oil and gas side. It's interesting to watch as a private company, because. Shareholder issues in the U.S. until the last few years with ESG, with the environmental, social, and governance movement that's there, Wall Street and investors have told certainly the large independent oil and gas companies, the Pioneers of the world and the Murphy Oils and others, they basically said, hey, with shale, why are you guys anywhere internationally? Come home. And so they first started penalizing a lot of oil and gas companies for thinking globally. And then when they came home, there's a real push in the oil and gas sector to go to one basin. So they basically, investors said, I can invest in a company as a pure play Bakken, shale player in North Dakota, in a pure play Eagle Ford, in a pure play Permian in Texas. You don't diversify, I'll diversify. And so they punished people and rewarded people accordingly. And so as you fast forward into 2020, in many ways, I could say our domestic oil and gas industry in many ways has been weakened by the very investment trends that the people that are now saying, why are you guys so weak, are the guys that kind of created that dynamic in the first place. And so I really do think a lot of the ability in the U.S. for oil companies to pivot into these new technologies is just limited, which is why it's great to be private. There's one guy I got to convince, he's on the eighth floor, I've known him for 52 years. And so it's just a lot easier. Internationally, I think they have the thinking correct. I mean, the challenge is, it's a little bit of the proof is in the pudding. I mean, BP went beyond petroleum at the same time that, you know, you've had Texas City, you had a lot of the challenges that we had as Prima Condo. You have a number of issues of the super majors internationally really being able to pivot into these other areas effectively. I do think this time may be different, but I'd also say the next breath, and look, you see this, it's like y'all. It is the entrepreneurial spirit here is what has allowed these technologies in oil and gas to evolve so quickly. It's why we've led shale and not the majors. It's really hard to see, in my opinion, the European super majors leading the way in these new technologies. So I think it's really bullish for Texas and in different players here.
Yeah, that's very interesting. So we're going to see that same level of innovation and velocity around some of these renewables right here in Texas, battery storage, things like that.
Yeah, I think in many ways, if you think about the shale, the people that dominate shale, putting aside Pioneer and Oxy, almost all the names today are names that didn't exist 15 years ago. And I wouldn't be surprised if there are names that just roll off the tip of the tongue of folks in the energy industry that don't even exist today when it comes to batteries.
Right,
and
a new EVs set of names.
And the new set of names,
yeah.
That's right.
Interesting, okay. I know we have just a few more minutes. I do want to get your perspective on you know, life in the midst of a pandemic and COVID and how that's going to change energy use and what lasting impact you might see with COVID.
With the pandemic?
Yeah, with the pandemic.
So, you know, it's... I think there are two aspects of that I think are kind of interesting. There's been a short-term question, and again, with us having feet in both the renewable world and the oil and gas world, there's a question of, you know, does green technology, does it win or lose out of the pandemic? And there are people that are saying, well, you know, it's going to dry up investment there, oil is cheaper, it's going to take longer to penetrate, and, you know, natural gas is cheaper. And there are people who are saying, well, no, actually, you know, if you really look at, if we're going to transition now, it's the time. Our head of technology here actually said, you know, it's probably more about resilience. And I think that probably is really true. If there's one thing coming out of this pandemic, and we personally think it, all you have to do is just look back at pandemics and epidemics that have kind of broken out. It feels like these are coming at a quicker pace. And we believe humanity is going to keep being humanity. We're going to keep moving, and we're going to keep having things that break out like this. Resilience is a pretty critical word now. And, you know, that will favor more and more distributed type resources over time. And so we do believe that over the next 20 to 30 years, there's going to be a propensity to see energy become more distributed and more localized. And so that's kind of one element of it. The other is something that is kind of near and dear to our heart. It's near and dear to y'all's hearts as well, just because of your interaction with the community. Over the 20th century, the reason why energy became cheap was because it was really an economies of scale model. It was a commodity out product. And so if it's a commodity that's replaceable, the best way to become profitable is lower your cost. You do that through economies of scale. And that kind of drove all of energy over the 20th century. But you can feel the backlash to it, not just in energy, but just in broader society. There's a real sense of there are these broad systems that aren't speaking to me as a person or me as a community. We look at that and we then look at the environmental side of this. And, you know, if you saw the picture of the jellyfish in the canals in Venice that were kind of lit up, I mean, these pictures from city centers of mountain backdrops that people haven't seen in decades in the developing world. I do think there's a lasting impact coming out of the pandemic of the delta between the shutdown and the short-term environmental impact that was there in community saying, wait a second, I actually kind of like seeing the mountaintop. And so I think when you put those two factors together, you know, it's fascinating. We're gonna, you know, we're at 100 million barrel a day world in January. We bottomed out somewhere, you know, around 79 to 81 million barrels a day of demand in April in the dark days. We're gonna end somewhere around 93. I mean, it's 7% off with a global, you know, recession. is pretty stunning. And almost by all accounts, we're gonna catch the old demand level within a year or two. So you could sit back with that and say, business as usual. But I think we really do look at this and say, I think this is more of a watershed moment, if nothing else, from a thinking perspective. The oil and gas industry in particular, utilities are afflicted with this. We tend to look at economic development, which needs energy, and we provide energy. And we tend to look at that relationship and that correlation and say, you need us to these communities. And therefore, here's our list of demands. And then as an industry, the oil industry, have been shocked that people hate us. And I think we're actually, we like to think when we've had success, it's because we flipped that around. We never forget people create the economic development. We're here to serve. And I think that mindset is one of the biggest things that's going to come out of the pandemic. Is I think the real winners are going to be focused on what do these communities want, how do we make communities more resilient, and how do we serve them, and that's our approach.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that, and I do agree. I think things will be different, and with this imprint, we may be connected in a more sort of meaningful way with each other, with the planet. So I think I really like what you said. There is something different in how we come out of this. So
yes, I can only imagine what's on the whiteboards in your office, because y'all are always at the forefront of this effort.
Yeah, well, thank you. Well, my understanding is we're up on time. So again, Hunter, I want to say thank you for sharing your perspectives. It was very, very interesting. And again, thank you so much for being part of this. And I know we're going to go to a live session here shortly. So Kimberly Britton, I think, will be leading our Q&A, and Hunter and I will be up here on stage ready to answer. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.